if it's real, I'm gonna keep it alive. Cause the road is long. There are mountains in our way, but yet we'll climb still higher every day. Lord, lift us up where we belong. Oh, yeah, when the eagles fly on the mountain high. Lord, lift us up where we belong. Yeah. Up on the world we know. To be, stop living your life looking behind.
Cause all we have is you right now, and our lives are in you to
find. Oh, but the road is still so very long. Yes, there are mountains in our way, but we won't worry, cause we'll climb higher every day.
Yes, Jesus, love me.
this I know. For the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Oh, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me.
Y'all is not dead, huh? I wanted to let that play.
No, he's not dead.
Hey, man, I was feeling that one in my bones. I wanted to let it keep.
Well, I felt because my dad used to listen to that every night when I was sleeping.
Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Glad you guys could join us today. My wife should be joining us and a few others. Right now we got Alfonso. Alfonso is on the phone.
Okay.
Welcome to brother.
Hey, Alfonso.
Sister Diane, brother Christian.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus. Somebody Zoom user. Can you, they're trying to connect in. Let's see who that is. Are you connected, Zoom user?
Yes, I'm connected. This is Yonku.
Sister Yonku, God bless you, man.
Yeah, Yonku.
My phone is all cracked up, so it's hard for me to change anything on here. The screen's all messed up, so forgive me.
Amen, amen. Glad you could join us. Well, I'm doing the mission statement this evening. Glad you guys could join us. We'll keep our mute buttons down so we can hear each other. We encourage each other to participate and allow the Holy Ghost to speak to the body of Christ for the edification of us and building of the church body. So our mission statement is collectively to come together for Bible study as we get to know each other personally, building genuine godly relationships. Only then can we truly come to love one another as our Lord has commanded. 1 John 3:23, and this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another. Amen. It does no good if you can prophesy or you can speak in tongues or you can do all the wonderful, magnificent gift if you don't have love. Love is the number one. So glad you guys could join us in. We're gonna do something different today. We're gonna have Brother Lemuel pray us in today and pray for the words that are coming out of our mouths, that the Holy Ghost just enlighten us and bless us on today in Jesus' mighty name. Go ahead, Lemuel.
Father, this evening, we come to you to study your word, Father. We want to just give you thanks for letting us be him. Thank you for going to the cross for us, forgiving our sin, Father. Father, be with us in our trials and our problems, and just be with us here on earth and guide us. Bring your spirit to us, Father. Put Satan under your feet, like you said in the scripture. Father, I'm going to just thank you for creating us, the sky, the creation, the sea, and everything was in it, Father. Help us this evening to understand what we're getting ready to discuss about your day, not man's day, but your day, the Lord's day. Father, keep us safe and keep us well. In Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Brother Lemuel. So we've been talking lately, we've been having a good discussion. Now our discussion we've been talking about is when Jesus returns. The Father let us know in Isaiah 13, 1 through 6, Isaiah said he saw a vision, and in his vision, he saw many nations that sound like a tumultuous noise in the mountain. And he said it was many nations from one end of the earth to the other one with the Lord of hosts leading them. Now, let me read that to you right here at 13, 1 and 6. The burden of Babylon, which Isaiah, the son of Amos, did see. Lift ye up a banner upon the high mountain, exalt the voice unto them, shake the hand that they may go into the house of the nobles. So right here, the Lord is letting us know to tell people about Jesus so they can wave the banner, which is Jesus Christ, so they can come into the house of the nobles. That's how you get to heaven, by coming the correct way through the door, Jesus Christ. Continuing on, I have commanded my sanctified ones. I also have called my mighty ones from my anger, even them that rejoice in my highness. The noise of a multitude in the mountains, like as of a great people, a tumultuous noise of the kingdoms of nations gathered together. The Lord of hosts mustereth the hosts of the battle. They come from a far country, from the end of heaven, even the Lord, and the weapons of his indignation, which is anger, to destroy the whole land. Man, that's scary right there, man. And they're aimed right at us. But we got to thank Jesus that he is patient with us. Jesus is doing us a favor and we don't even know it. We think he's slow to come, or we think he ain't gonna never come. He is doing us a favor by not coming right now, by giving us time to be able to come the correct way. So in this beautiful, awesome word we got right here, when he come and he shake the world, look what's going to happen right here, Isaiah 2:18. And the idols he shall utterly abolish, and they shall go into the holes of the rocks and into the caves of the earth for fear of the Lord and for the glory of his majesty when he arises to shake the terribly the earth. In that day, man shall cast his idols of silver and his idols of gold, which they made each one for himself to worship, to the moles and into the bats, to go into the clefts of the rocks and into the tops of the ragged rocks for fear of the Lord and for the glory of his majesty when he arises to shake terribly the earth. Cease ye, man, whose breath is in his nostrils, for wherein is he to be accounted of? Amen. Let's dig back in here. Let's go in here and dive in here. And what is this word telling us? We see right here, don't make yourself an idol in this world. He's coming to abolish utterly the idols. All of you basketball players, all of you big stars, and ain't leading people to Christ, but leading people to yourself and your own glory. He said he's coming to destroy you utterly. And he said, you're going to be so scared, you're going to go into the holes of the rocks and into the caves of the earth for fear of the Lord and for the glory of his majesty when he arises to shake the earth. Ain't that what he said, Lemuel?
Yes, what he said.
So I just titled this, we got to be careful in this world. We got to be careful not to allow ourselves to become an idol to where people are worshiping us. People is looking up to us and we leading them to damnation.
Well, as I was reading it, you know, well, of course, dear, I'm into my commentary. But what I'm saying is, it's the Lord's Day. You know, this is the Lord's Day. Man has his day on earth. You know, they have things they like to worship, you know. And this is about, you know, the Lord having his day. But one part I was reading, when I was reading it, it says about religious people, you know, they have all kinds of practice. They even go to the point that they would kiss the ground, you know, like in some worship they do, you know. But when they really actually have to face God, they have to start with their pride, you know. Uh-huh. The pride comes in, you know. It's okay when they were doing all the worshiping and everything, but when it really comes to worshiping God, they lose their pride.
Right. You know? Amen.
But I hate. I'm just gonna skip down to the last. You know, it just says, you know. CG for man whose breath is his nostrils, but within is he to be accounted of.
Right.
And which is true, you know. A lot of people listen to man more than listen to the word of God or reading the word of God. In other words, they praise man more, you know, the presidents and everybody, you know, just what you were saying earlier, than God.
Right.
But yet they don't realize it's the same God, it's the same breath of man you listen to comes from God.
Right.
Yeah.
Amen. Good to see you, Charles and Jessica. Thank you for joining us.
Hello, Charles.
They just joined us. So, Brother Alfonso, what do you think about that word right there, sir? You, Alfonso, but it almost seems like to me that, you know, people have gotten really good positions, it seems like, in this world. How can you not know that there's a God that lifted you, that allowed you to make it there? How would you not give him glory? How can you not give him praise?
Yeah, people can't identify what they don't see. They see man. And they see man, so they started glorifying and worshiping man. And I like, they like to eat from the bitch's mouth. They don't want to eat from the word of God, they eat from the bitch's mouth. So they just read what they can understand and they regurgitate it easily. So that's why people can get a memorization of the word of God, but really, does the word of God really get into their heart? Have they really had that encounter? They mm-hmm. may have an encounter with a pastor or somebody ministers to them, and they see more of that person than they see in themselves, but they haven't had their encounter with the living God, the risen mm-hmm. God, that lays them down so they can live.
But look at the book of Romans tell us that there's clearly visible things here to know that the invisible things exist. There's things here that man didn't make. That's visible. You don't need to see, you don't need a vision. Man look for a sign. You don't need to see God. He got enough of himself revealed visibly if you're looking at what I'm looking at in the world, to know that he exists.
So what I want, one of the main reasons, I mean, I have to remind myself every single day who God is, who am I? Because the world tells me every single day, love yourself, you are good, follow your dreams. The world is the enemy. The enemy is constantly programming us to put ourselves first, you know? And so it's not just us fighting ourselves, but it's also the enemy affirming our sins, our sinful thoughts of putting ourselves first. It's just the way we were conceived. We were conceived in sin, and that is the way we think. So that is why God says to go into the Word of God, which will then renew our mind. It will detox all the lies of this world and ourselves out of us. That's and when we don't do it, then we have pride. Even when we do read the Word of God, we still sometimes are like those where when Christ says, you know, when a person looks at a mirror and then goes away and forgets, you know, how he looks like. A lot of us are like that. We will open up our Bible. We will read the scripture. We will say, okay, thank you, Lord, I get it now. And then we close the book. And then we go back to the way we were doing things, like a dog going back to its vomit. And it's because we're not sincerely convicted in our hearts, so broken down that we repent. And we say, Lord God, you come first. I am nothing. And I think that that genuine repentance needs to come every single day for us to do. Mm-hmm.
Amen. Mommy. Beautiful. Amen. Anybody else want to expound on that? Charles, Jessica? What you guys think about that word?
Like Phoebe is not a horse.
Amen.
It reminds me of the when you know you say how can people not, you know, see that they're the God, how could you not give it praise? And it just makes me think about how, you know, what Paul was telling the church of Corinth in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, where he says, you know, if our gospel is hidden, it's hidden to those who are perishing. But he said, those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded.
Right.
So those who do not believe, least the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ should shine unto them. You know, Satan has, you know, been working, you know, tirelessly to blind the eyes of you know, people to see the glory of God. You know, he's done that in part by creating so much turmoil and destruction and death in the world that it makes everyone question the existence of God. So if the men and women of God, if the children of God aren't really, you know what I'm saying, shining forth the light of the gospel, it's hard for those who, you know, have their eyes blinded to really see.
Right.
So, you know, Christ charges us to let our light shine so that we see, you know what I'm saying, our Father's good works and glorify him. And so as we continue to make a difference in the lives of those around us that who we rub shoulders with on a regular daily basis and helping them to see the light, you know, we can play a huge part in helping people to be able to see the glory of God just by the way we let our light shine.
Amen. Amen. I agree with you, Charles, on that. Our forefathers and ancestors, they dropped the ball. See, that's why I said train up a child. That's how I got here in the Lord, by my mom instilling Jesus in me. Jesus was going to do the rest of the work. And I always called on that name. So I like that. I like that. Yeah. But this is these are important things because we're looking at making ourselves an idol, number one on the list. Number two, we're looking at putting materialism and money and idols before the king. And number three, what Lemuel was just mentioning, cease ye from man. See, a lot of people don't know that your breath is in the Lord. So when he appeared to shake the earth, where are you going to be accounted for? Because your breath is in him. So when you cease from man, because your breath is in him, and the whole time you ain't been given the one whom your breath is in the praise. Go ahead, Alfonso. God bless you.
I'm right with you, man. I'm just listening. Your breakfast in here. I'm just taking my notes. I like that.
Amen. And these are things that we have to be able to bring, like Charles was saying, to the forefront so people can see. You got to get around men of God who ain't scared to preach this word. You can't, people that stand in the realm, God hasn't opened the understanding for them to understand his word. You need to get around men of God who are going to dive in his word and give you the truth of it. Right here, he said he's coming back to crush the idols utterly. People who are putting money in idols before him, he coming to get them too. They're going to throw their golden idols into the bats and the moles. And they're going to want the bats and the moles to hide the stuff that they've been putting for God from them.
One more thing to add. We have to remember and be sober that the reason why Satan was thrown out of heaven is because of pride. And that is what God hates the most. It's even in the scriptures. One thing God hates most is pride. And we need to realize there's nothing for us to be prideful about. Everything we have is God's.
Right.
Everything we are is God's. Even the breath, as Brother Charles and Brother Derek has mentioned, is from him. He breathed his spirit into us. Right. So even that we're breathing is him. Until he calls and says, he commands the breath out of us, you know, we're here at his mercy.
Right.
So there's this, God has been teaching me to have a balance of fear for him and to also understand his perfect love. A lot of us, a lot of Christians either go the either extremes. Some Christians are so legalistic, they go into the fear side of God. And then others go into complete liberalism. You know, they just completely trust that, oh, God will forgive me for whatever I do. Let me just have fun, you know. And that is both wrong. That is both evil. We need to know that we have to have fear of God because he is God. There's no one above him. He is God.
Amen.
But at the same time, he loves us. He wants us to be saved. And his blood is there ready to cover us as long as we accept it.
Uh-huh.
And we know that he will take care of us.
Amen.
We need to understand both. And then that is where we have security. We can hide in him. We fear him. We hide in him. Uh-huh. And we realize that we're frail. There's nothing in us. And even people around us. God has been so merciful to me through my journey in this life so far where you know, there are a lot of people who we idolize, even just, you know, even even our own siblings or our own, you know, family members and stuff. But then God's beginning to open my eyes and say, you know what? That person, I'm going to make that person disappoint you. I'm going to make that person, you know, do something to disappoint you. And then, so that I realize that that person is just a man. That person is just a woman like me. They're no better. We all need to forgive each other,
right.
Be merciful, but don't idolize each other. Only God. Mm-hmm. You can only serve one master. We cannot serve two masters.
Right. Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah.
Amen. Thank you, brothers. Yeah, thank you.
What do you think about that, Brother Christian?
I'm here. Oh, hey, I got kicked off the thing twice.
Amen.
I think she's exactly spot on. You know, at the end of the day, it was grace that saved us, and that when we take our eyes off Christ,
mm-hmm.
what ends up happening is we kind of pollute the love and the grace,
mm-hmm.
you know, that is so awesome that we can't even really begin to understand it, you know. That's what I got to say, guys.
I like that, crazy. So real quick, let's look at our note right quick, and it's coming out of Luke 21, out of the New Testament of Jesus Christ, 26 through 27. Now, this is the Father speaking to Isaiah right here, showing Isaiah this in the Old Testament. Let's look at what it says right here. Men's hearts fell in them for fear and looking after those things that are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with great power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift your heads, for your redemption draws nigh. So reading this just allowed me to see that all of this and what the gospel and what the Old Testament with Isaiah is saying in this end time word, it just puts it all together. When the Lord shakes the earth terribly and appear in the clouds, all we're going to do is look up. And there's going to people going to be doing things from what this word tells us right here. All the idols who put themselves above God, got people following them and didn't point to Christ. Because the Bible tells us, it's like Charles was saying, the people that are perishing, the gospel is foolish to them. That's one. We know that the Romans and Apostle Paul, which the Holy Ghost power lets us know that there is visible, clear evidence here that God exists.
Praise God. Well, hello, everyone. Praise God. I'm sorry.
Hey, Michelle.
Hello. I'm sorry. I had to make a couple stops and got in late, and I'm sorry I was late, but I'm glad I caught some of the study, and it sounds like a really good study, and I just wanted to speak on it just a little bit, talking about the idols. I've been reading on this, on the idols, and one thing about that I didn't realize in my studying and my reading in Ezekiel, I didn't realize, I mean, I knew that idol, it's one of the 10 commandments, not to worship idols, not to put any idol, anything before God, but I didn't realize how angry and upset God is about that. When you start reading that book of Ezekiel, and how the people there turned away from God to idols, false idols. How God really,
mm-hmm.
he really doesn't like that. And I knew he didn't, but reading that book, it really, really lets you know how God is a jealous God, and he desires that we put no one before him.
Right.
Whether it's an idol, whether it's a figure of an idol, whether an idol can be ourselves. Some people are so into their selves, they make their selves an idol.
Right.
You know, so I, you know, anything that you worship, anything that you put before God,
mm-hmm.
ooh, you know, and so we have to reverence God and honor God and ooh, know what God's place is to us in our lives.
Right.
But it's really, for me, Yeah, it just makes you look at things like how you're spending your time and truly what you're putting your heart in. What are you? What are you putting above God?
Right.
You know, are you dedicating and being more committed to your job or to things? Mm-hmm. And it'll make you think, you know, really like a check, like, you know, because I think most people think of idol maybe just as like, you know, I'm worshiping this figure or this, you know, this statue. But it's about a lot more than that. You know, we can idolize our children. We can idolize our spouses.
Mm-hmm.
We can idolize, you know, of course, material things. But, you know, God, you get into that book of Ezekiel. That's right. Not a good thing. God does not like that at all.
Amen. I like that.
Yeah, the whole chapter about God being jealous, you know, just like Michelle said, our God is a jealous God, you know, so.
Amen.
Yeah, I understand about the idol, yeah.
So real quick, we got 7 minutes, so we're going to go in a little bit further too, because just like the wife just touched on, we got to understand anything that you put above God is an idol. YouTube, Facebook, reading all these different books that ain't got no power of the gospel, doing anything that you're putting above the kingdom of God can be considered an idol and is an idol.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the stuff that we have to be aware of. Where are we delegating our time? Who are we committed to? Are we committed to our job? I was working on this job, and every time the boss was telling them to do something, they run to another job for $3 or $4 extra. You ain't never allowing Christ to work in your character to build patience, to build temperance, to build long suffering, because every time it get going, you run. So how is Christ building the fruits of the Spirit in you if every time you look around, you taking off to a different job?
Overtime.
See, you can't serve two masters. If you serve in Christ Jesus, you got to stay down and stick with it. You got to persevere. Long suffering. There's things that Christ is trying to work in your life. How is he working in your life? But every time you turn around, you're running and chasing the mighty dollar because somebody that made you mad at this job.
Oh.
Come on, let's talk about it, man. Patience, long suffering, temperance. How is that working? If you're not at a job, tell me, if you're not at a job, how is that working? You owning your own business, how is that working? And you ain't never worked for nobody. How is that working? That's why we have to be careful what we're doing in this life. God has set this life up for a reason, for us to go through and for us to work our character. But if we're too busy, don't know how to brush our teeth, but we want to own our own business, and instead of you getting up going to work for somebody so God can build character in you, how is you working it?
Mm.
Can I add on to that?
Amen.
Just a little bit. I want to add, we're talking about building that character and God allowing the Lord and the Holy Spirit to work on you. You know what? I was just thinking when you were talking about that at the job, but I was just more so thinking in relationships. Just daily relationships. He's working on you then. He's building on you then. Every relationship you have is working on you. It's working on your patience. It's working on your long suffering. It's working on your being understanding. It's working on yours taking the low road. It's, you know, every relationship you have in this world, in life, whether it's with a brother or a sister, whether it's with your natural family, whether it's with your employers, your boss at work or your employers, and that's how we should, that's what the Holy Spirit has been showing me. That's what we really need to concentrate on, because we have to learn relationship. We really do. We have to learn. And through that, we get to know who we are. Mm-hmm. Really, you get to know who you are in different relationships. You know, everybody's different. You're dealing with different personalities, right? And sometimes I know I'm in the medical field. And sometimes I get really feisty patients, and you get difficult patients, and then you have your nice, sweet patients. But the thing about it is, it's all to make us and to help us, though, build our character, because everybody doesn't have the same those rough edges and those what do I want to say, more controversial people, I guess, or difficult people, some may say, but that helps you. That builds us because, you know, it helps you to build your patience and your kindness,
right?
You know, especially on my job. My job is can be very stressful, you know, mm-hmm. and I'm dealing with a whole bunch of different people with a whole bunch of different personalities,
mm-hmm.
you know? And so, you know, it me being a woman of God and being a believer, I look at that as each day it's helping me, it's working on me, you know? And then in essence, when you get out here and you're ministering and you're doing your ministry, whatever ministry you have, you're gonna be working with people. Right. You're still working and dealing with people. And I think in the body, I really think that for me, really, what I see in the body of Christ, we need to learn relationships. I think we need to learn to get stronger in relationships. And what I mean by that is not so much looking at the other person, I think, but individually looking at ourselves.
Amen.
Because, you know, learning relationships, that's all I want to say. I think we need to learn relationships.
Amen. That was powerful. So we got a minute and a half. Anybody want to comment on that before we come back? And any final thoughts? That was a good word, honey. Good word, definitely.
Yeah.
Mm.
The only thing that I wanted to say was I have to remember humility and to be humble.
Yes, I do.
I need to come humble to God. I need to come humble to others because and when people, you know, might thank me for something that I've done that's nice, that's, you know, that's maybe helped them or something, and they'll thank me, and I do say you're welcome, but I tell them it's all God, because I am absolutely nothing without God. And I thank him for all that he does for me every single day, every morning when I wake up, that he gives me the breath, that he's given me the gift of seeing another beautiful and glorious day that he has made that I will be glad in. So, you know, I have to approach things that way. And I have to continually, it reminds me, when I tell others, this is not me doing this, this is God. Because I am nothing without him. I wouldn't be able to do this without him. There's no way. And building those relationships with people. Yeah, Sister Michelle's very, very correct. We do need to build those relationships with everyone. And we have to build that